Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Sports Fans. I'm Jeff Blinderman, your host. Very fortunate to be joined by a local boxing show tonight. With that, we welcome in Felix Nance, John DeCastro, and Jody Shealy to talk a lot about boxing in this particular episode. But Jody and I reconvened for the purposes of Sports Fans, Jody, to talk a little bit about the Connecticut Silver Gloves Tournament that you have going on in early December at Teachers Memorial School, and that's the primary reason for us getting together. And we have a little bit of a special surprise. Felix Nance has come back to the area, and we're going to certainly get into his boxing background along with John DeCastro's. But what precipitated you putting this program together?
Well, Jeff, we were trying to do a show locally just to get the word out to some kids, to, you know, get more kids to the gym. And Teachers Memorial, my son Brandon is a student over there in eighth grade, and they've been trying to raise money for through the PTO. They lost money for the sports funding and stuff for that, for the school. And I got talking with Dan Spellman, who's the PTO president, who saw us on the show, on your show last time, and actually was asking about it. And we started talking, and we approached the principal and the superintendent about doing a show, and, you know, all the proceeds are going to go back to the PTO, and then some are going to go to the gym, which I run on my own money as it is. And, you know, so it's for the kids, the bottom line, you know. So we got this thing together, and it's going to be, you know, it's an advancement tournament, so it's for kids ages 8 to 16. If they win, they go on to New York and fight in the regionals. But also we're going to have boxers from my gym plus other gyms around the state that are older that are going to fight outside the tournament that night.
And in the second part of this show, we're going to have some of the fighters that will be fighting from your gym in the tournament. We'll talk to them, we'll get some more details. But if you could throw a phone number out where people could call to get some more information between now and then.
Yeah, they could call Teachers Memorial, the middle school. It's 823-4212, and they have all the info there. They have tickets on hand to sell. Also at IM Wireless in Norwich Town. It's in the Ace Hardware store in the back. Dan Spellman owns that. He's selling tickets through there, and they could call my house, which says the gym on a flyer, which is my house. And that's 889-4647.
Very good, Jody, and we'll certainly get back to this as the show proceeds. But a couple of months ago, you called me up and you said, Jeff, how'd you like to have Felix Nance on the show and tell me a little bit about Felix's background? I get all excited. So, Felix, you know, coming in today from California, it's great to have you back in the area.
Thank you.
Can you tell the people out there who don't know about your boxing background how you got started, and then what prompted you to come back and give a little bit back to the southeastern Connecticut boxing community?
Well, I got started. I grew up in the 70s when boxing used to be a street sport, and I loved it so much I just took it to the ring, and from there just kept fighting. I thought I was getting knocked out my first time in the ring, but I didn't. It took it natural, and fought Golden Gloves, fought PAL, was doing pretty good with it. Then I moved to New England, and I had quit, got the itch back again, and went back into the ring. And I fought Marlon Stalin, beat him in the amateurs, knocked him out, and that's how I made a name in New England. And went from there.
Now, when you fought Marlon Starling and you knocked him out, did you at that point realize how big a name Marlon Starling would end up being in Connecticut?
No, I didn't. Okay. You know, we just fight amateurs at the time.
Yeah. Now, for the kids out there that do tend to like to fill it up, I guess I should say, from time to time outside on the streets, you know, what's the difference basically between getting into a fight in a street fight when you're a kid and then kind of taking that aggression into the ring?
Well, it's a lot of concentration and dedication. In the street, you just go at it and just throw anything at you. In the ring, it's more controlled. And you basically fight from the heart, what you love doing, and that's it.
Now, John, the last time you were on the show, when we had the boxing show, that kind of came to be that I got from some of the answers you gave me.
Right.
That, you know, every once in a while you got entangled out there and you decided it was kind of fun and maybe right. You were going to start to do it a little bit more in an official setting.
Well, yeah, you develop a passion for it, you know, and the training is part of it, and actually the fighting in the ring is secondary to the training. It becomes after a point. But the competition is what you're striving to, what you're getting out of it.
Now, anyone who sits there and watches a fight on TV or is fortunate enough to see one in person and then sees the warriors after the fight and what they look like, and unless you're up close or you get to sit next to somebody after a fight, you really don't realize what they go through. Even sometimes the guys that win the fights look like they've just been through a riot or a war. And people, I'm sure, invariably think to themselves, what would possess someone to put their body through this? You guys are doing it because you love to do it. How bad was it after? I mean, how did you feel? How did you get yourself back into the ring once you went through it once?
Well, afterwards, you feel the pain, and you hurt, but as part with being in the ring at the time, it's something you love doing, you have the passion for it, and you just, adrenaline just going, just keep pushing you. Whether you win or lose, it's that adrenaline just keep you pushing, keep you going, and that's what I love about it.
How much does the win-lose part factor into it? If you lose and you fight a good fight, do you feel that bad versus if you win and you don't fight a good fight? Does it mean it's against you, even though it's you against an opponent? For instance, if you're fighting somebody that you know is better than you, maybe you fight Vinny Pazienza, and you sparred against them, but you give it everything you have, and that was the best fight you ever fought. Are you okay with it? Or is John DeCastro walking out after saying, man, I still can't beat him?
If you put your whole effort into it, and you know you put your best foot forward, you get satisfaction to that. But by the same token, if you get that little bit of doubt that in your mind that you could have done a little bit better, if you trained a little bit harder, or if something in the training process disrupted you, and that you feel that you can go back and train again harder and get a rematch. A lot of times on the rematches, you end up winning.
A lot of heart goes into fighting. You know, a lot of fighters get tired. A lot of fighters get hit early. A lot of fighters maybe not fight their best fight the first couple of rounds when they need to, and then all of a sudden they're in a street brawl. For instance, like a Mickey Ward, Arturo Gatti, one fight where Ward didn't look like he was going to make it out of the second round, and then Gatti didn't look like he was going to make it out of the seventh or eighth round. In the tenth round, they're standing there. It's like a Rocky movie, and you see two warriors that have gone toe-to-toe for 30 minutes. You guys have all certainly been involved in that. What's that like? What keeps you standing?
The adrenaline and the love for the sport. You know I can get this guy, and you're going to give it your best you can. He's going to have to knock me out to win this fight. Win or lose, he had to knock me out if he won't win this fight.
Even though you have nothing left in
the
tank.
Even though you got nothing left, I'm going all the way to the end. That happened to me with McGurk the last fight. He beat me for 9 rounds, but I stood there for the whole round, and I was going to give it all I had. And that's the adrenaline that's keeping you going.
Now, when you watch the fights, Felix, and you see a Buddy McGurk, for the people that don't know, is Arturo Gatti's trainer. When you see him on TV in the corner, do you stand up and tell everyone in the room that you fought him and, whenever it was, wherever it was, and what the outcome was?
Yes, I do, and I get a kick out of it because now he's one of the top trainers in the world, and he made a lot of progress since then, and it does make me feel good. I fought one of the best out there.
A lot of times they say that sometimes the best players don't make the best coaches. How about in boxing? Do the best fighters make the best trainers?
Depends on the person. It's not always true. Depends on the individual. In his case, he's one of the best in the world right now.
Now, you had a very unique situation, and for the people that don't realize, while you were fighting, instead of just being a professional fighter, you carried a job. You were a welder at EB, and you were in Madison Square Garden one night, and the next morning you were back in Groton
to work.
Doing your job. How was it to balance those two things?
Well, it wasn't easy, but the love of the sport is either I can just quit and say I can't do it because I'm working, or go ahead and give it the best I can. But I had to work, so I did that, and since I love boxing so much, I didn't want to just quit and say, well, what could I have done, or what could I have been? So I just kept going with it. I stayed maybe longer than I should have, but it was just love of the sport that kept me going.
Now, as we continue, some 18 years from when you retired from professional fighting, if my math is correct, you're still involved with the training of boxing, not necessarily the sparring, but using it as a vehicle to keep yourself in some pretty good physical shape.
Yes, that's the way I know how to keep myself in shape, and I still do it today.
Okay.
The hitting the bag and the jumping rope and stuff like that.
Now, you're here to give something back to Jody's endeavor, and we're going to get to that in a second. But, John, you and Jody also got back together at some point not too long ago, and you put in a day or two or a night or two at Jody's Second Chance Gym in Norwich to give something back to the youngsters that, from what I got out of the last conversation, some of the kids that we're going to have on later were a lot like you guys when you were younger.
Yeah, definitely. Actually, today is 1 year that the gym's been open. It was October 24th they registered the gym, and it's ironic that we're on tonight.
Happy anniversary.
Thanks. And, I mean, like I said before, last time we had Tony Papagallo on, who Tony's not a kid off the street. He's you know, he's a tough kid. He gives it his all, and the reason why he's playing football at Grizzled, and so he's been busy. But you know, this, I told you, all walks of life can come in the door there. I don't care. You know, if a kid can't afford a pair of shoes, you know, we'll get him something. You know, get him set up.
You know, and by and large, John, do you see this as an opportunity for kids to use the ring as a vehicle to control their aggression? For some kids, they probably use it as a vehicle to, if they're thinking of going down a path that isn't so wonderful, mm-hmm. to at least channel that aggression into something that's constructive. And even though they're fighting, it's an off-the-street fighting thing
right.
that, you know, obviously you've got to put in a lot of training, and you can't be partaking in some of the things that kids on the streets mm-hmm. do, so it keeps them clean.
Most definitely. I think that you channel your energy into that sport, you're gonna find that you don't really want to get involved on the other side of the, you know, the street fighting situation, and you're gonna walk away from fights that you would normally get into on a whim on the street, whereas you're disciplined in boxing, you know what you can do in the street if you ever ended up in that situation. As a trained fighter, you could really hurt somebody out in the street.
Felix, did that situation ever present itself to you? Professional fighter out there minding your own business in line at the movies or in the grocery store, and somebody says or does something, and you kind of have to stop and think, wait a minute, I'm not 14 on the streets. I really know what I'm doing, and I'll probably kill this person.
Fortunately, no. I don't bother nobody, and unfortunately, nobody has messed with me. And I guess I've just been fortunate in that part.
Right.
I don't get no trouble, and nobody really pushed me to it.
Have you ever seen other professional fighters that, you know, get themselves in situations where all of a sudden now they're in public?
I have seen that, yes.
It gets ugly, doesn't it?
It gets ugly, yeah.
Howie Davis Jr., and that's a name that some people may not remember, but when I was a kid, I remember, I believe he fought in the same Olympics that Sugar Ray Leonard did.
Right.
And he wasn't as well-known as Sugar Ray, but he was pretty well-known.
Yeah.
And you also had the opportunity to fight him. He was a 1976 Olympic gold medalist. I believe those were the Olympics in Montreal.
Right.
What was it like to fight Howard Davis?
Well, I fought him in the New York Golden Gloves semifinals, and I knew going into the fight he was the world amateur champion. They wanted him for the Olympics. I knew I had to knock him out to win. So I gave him all my head, and I lost the decision to him.
Close
decision.
As you think back now and you size up how you fared against Howard, do you think you won the fight?
No, I didn't. I thought he outpointed me. So.
Okay.
But I gave him all
I had. It was close?
It was a close fight.
Okay. What do you think some of the differences were between his skill level and yours at the time?
He was a lot slicker boxer, a lot quicker. You know, me, if I can't get to you and really hurt you early, then I have problems during the later rounds, and that was my problem.
All right, now for the people out there that watch fights on TV and have never seen one up close, can you talk a little bit about, because on TV everything seems slower. Mm. You know, obviously you don't get the sense on TV of how quickly the punch is coming, nor for that matter how it feels once it lands. You know, you've seen fights on TV, but you've also been in the ring. What's
right.
the difference?
Well, they come very fast, and you got to be in training to know how to get out the way of them. You don't catch them all. Sometimes you get caught with them, but you got to know how to absorb it and, you know, get back to it, throw back at them.
What happens when you get maybe the wind knocked out of you during a fight? How do you, you get the wind knocked out in your backyard and you're down on the ground for 20 seconds before you can get up in a fight? You don't have that luxury. What happens then?
You got to try to suck it up and just get back up and get back in there.
Okay. Very good. Boxing highlight as you think back now, years later. Of all the things that you've done as an amateur or a professional, what is the single boxing accomplishment that you're most proud of?
There's quite a few of them, but I came back and fought the New England title, won that professionally, and that was probably the one single one I had, fighting with Marlon Starlin as a sparring partner, and that helped me a lot. That's my last few years, and that was probably my best.
Now, Marlon was, I don't remember what level champion Marlon was, but out of Hartford, Marlon was.
Yeah, he was a WBA champ.
Knock Mark Breland out.
All right.
So, at that time that you fought Marlon, I mean, how were your skills compared to his?
Well, I fought him in the amateurs, and when I knocked him out, that gave me a name in New England. Then we fought twice after that in the amateurs, and he beat me those two times. And since then, I never fought him as a pro. But I think back on that, he went a long way because he had people backing him up so he can go full-time, which I didn't. Now, if I had somebody backing me up, maybe I would have been there too.
But if somebody had ever come up to you in one of the gyms that you trained and said, hey, kid, I like you, you know, I've got $25,000, $50,000, whatever it takes, that some of my buddies and I put together, would you be interested in being backed if we could pay your bills for you for a year or two?
No, nobody ever done that for me, no.
What would you have said if they had?
I would have took it.
Okay.
I would have loved to go full-time and tried it.
All right. Now, the boxers that do train full-time to do it professionally, how many hours a day do they train approximately?
Probably about 5-6 hours a day. They get to get up in the morning, do their road work, go down to the gym, work out 3 hours. I mean, that's their job. That's their profession. Well, I get up in the morning, run before work, go work 8 hours at the shipyard, then go to the gym for 2 hours, and I'm already tired when I get down there.
Yeah.
And Phil would be driving to Hartford to train up
there. Drive hours to the gym.
And drive back that night.
Now, how I know one of the reasons, Jody, that you got into this is because of your love for boxing and what it did for you when you were at a crossroads in your development. But Southeastern Connecticut could also use a place or another place for youngsters to come and train. So I know kind of all those things factored in. For the people that didn't catch your story the last time you were on Sports Fans, can you give them a brief overview of how Second Chance Gym came to be?
Well, just I got involved in boxing downtown, actually, with Felix and John were at when I was about 15, and not too long after, had a couple of bouts there, and not too long after that, the gym closed, and so we used to go up, Juan Rivera used to run the gym in Norwich, used to bring John and myself and a couple other guys up to Hartford to Bellevue Square a little while later, and we used to go up there and train, and then that lasted for a little while, and it phased out, and, you know, I was always in and out, and just kind of around the wrong things, and then Felix popped back up in the neighborhood not too long after, and I was around 20, 21, and Felix used to, I used to have a gym set up in my basement, padded walls and stuff, and he used to come over there and work with me, used to go run together and stuff, and then through the years, so I was 30, 32, you know, I was still in and out of it and around it, but, you know, I mean, like I said, and then when I finally walked away from it, I said, you know, I told my wife, said, you know, if I ever get back into this, well, I'd love to train kids someday, maybe have a gym. And this thing came about, this house we looked at 2 years ago, and it's a 4-car garage. I saw it, I envisioned it, and, you know, two of the garages, I made a gym, and I got a ring in there and bags, and it's working.
Build it, and they will come.
Yeah, well, you know, it is a dream, and it's one being fulfilled, and it's happening quicker than I thought, and you know, I'm getting some kids, some are staying, some are leaving, you know. Some train harder than others, you know. I put the main focus on the kids that work hard, and I tell them that from the start. If you don't work hard, you know, don't be surprised, I don't spend too much time with you. And John comes up, gives me a hand when I can, goes to the fights, and you know the story, what I call it, what I do, and, it's close to home. It's close to home, it's close to my heart, and it means a lot.
What's it mean to you to have a John DeCastro come and work guys out, or have a Felix Nance fly 3,000 miles back to come to see this, or have a Teddy Atlas when he's at the Mohegan Sun stop by and, you know, shake your hand and snap a few pictures? I mean, those are some pretty big boxing names.
Yeah, and actually Teddy Atlas, one of the first things he saw when he came into the gym, he saw Felix's picture on a wall, and he said he fought one of my guys. Felix fought Kevin Rooney, and when Teddy was working with him in Golden Gloves in the late 70s. It means a lot having John come up. You know, I always known John through the years, and we didn't really run into each other all the time, but from here and there, and when I told him I was going to try to get a place together, you know, I don't want anyone else up there. Too many cooks spoil the stew, and that's just the way I want. It sounds selfish, but you know what? It's the way I kind of running it, but John is a welcome piece because he's got a lot of knowledge, and, you know, the analogy I make is, you know, I put the shoe polish on all week, try to shine it, and John comes and spit shines it, you know, so... That's the difference.
Now, I had the opportunity to come up to the gym and see you guys work with some of the youngsters when it first opened, and I was, you know, you have a vision, Jeff. I've got a gym in my basement. I mean, in my garage. I'm sorry. Come check it out. You have in your mind what you think it's going to be, and then you get there, you know, and it's a lot better and a lot nicer and a lot further developed than one would think one would have in their garage, particularly in Norwich.
Lou DePina, who's a rec director, Lou sent me some kids, actually one of the kids I'm bringing on, the second half, he got my name through Lou, and Lou stopped by the other day to see it, and he was surprised that it is what it is. It's not a lot, but if you understand boxing, when you walk in that place.
Oh, yeah.
Something.
There's some history on the walls there.
Yeah, oh, yeah.
There absolutely is. Now, talk a little bit about Mickey Ward and why he represents professional boxing in terms of how special it is to you. What is it about him, I guess, is what I'm asking, that appeals to you from a professional boxing standpoint?
You know, he's a classy guy. He doesn't go out carousing, doesn't go out being a big shot, you know. Always fought his heart out, you know. Fought hard, you know, had a ton of losses, you know, but always fought hard, you know, like Felix talked, you know. Felix is a guy, too. You know, he retired at 10-9-1, but, you know, Felix fought the best guy. This guy's out there at 30-0 right now, and welterweights that couldn't fight one of those guys that he fought. You know, they feed him tomato cans these days and build the records up, then they get in a guy who's good, and they lay down.
Alan, if you can please send out those pictures that we froze for Felix before the show started. Felix, coming up on the screen here, we've got some pictures. If you could describe what you see there.
That's back in 82. Me, John, and old trainer Juan Rivera. I was happy to see them. Let's go way back.
Yeah, you guys have different hairstyles.
Oh, I got no hair now.
That's a deal. Gym down on Main Street.
Main Street. Old gym down there.
Theater.
Okay. All right. How about the next one?
We used to spar together. We just taking a picture
that
there.
That was in the Golden Gloves finals of the Western Mass tournament. 1982. Me and Felix in the before the fight, I was fighting in the finals of the Western Mass tournament against a guy that Felix fought as a pro a few years later.
Actually, when I saw that Elliot picture Williams. Tonight, I was at that fight. I drove up with Felix. I saw the picture because I remember being at the Elliot Williams fight.
21 years ago.
Yeah.
And how about that one right there? There are a couple of guys that are coming on.
Yep, that's Jesse and Joey. That was up at a show that Peter Rogers did a few months back up in Plainfield.
Okay. Felix, can you talk a little bit about what it was like to fight on the Marvin Hagler undercard?
Oh, it was a good fight to fight on the undercard of Marvin Hagler because I respected Marvin, and I got the opportunity to go fight him, and they told me I was going to fight Davey Moore. And I fought Davey Moore twice in the amateurs, and there were two hell of good fights, so I knew what he was like, and we fought again as a pro, and that was another good fight. And his coach walked to me and said, "Oh, we're going to fight you again?" So, of course, every fight we had was just wars, and David Moore went on to become a world champion, so that's another accomplishment for me. I fought somebody that went on to become a champion.
And now here you get a chance to fight Figueroa for the New England title.
That's after I went to fight with with Marlon Starling, and got a chance to fight for the New England title. I beat him once. And gave him a rematch and beat him again. That was a tough fight. He was tough. But I pulled it out and won the decision.
Good for you. Now, you fought on the Hagler undercard. You fought Howard Davis. I'm sure at some point you got pretty close to Sugar Ray Leonard. I don't know if you were anywhere near Thomas Hearns, but if you've either sparred with any of those guys, a couple of them you fought, certainly some of them you've seen train or have been at some of their fights. What set those guys apart, do you think, from the guys like yourself that weren't able to do it professionally?
Most of them made a name for themselves in the Olympics, which helped you big, getting your name up to the top. And plus, they were doing it full-time because they had the name there. And I'm working my way up. It's a big difference. You know, I'll tell any kid now, if you're fighting amateur, go for the gold medal. If you get that gold, you can make it.
All right. Now, if you do run into a kid, and I'm sure you do, and you give him the advice, and then the kid goes and he wins the gold medal.
Mm-hmm.
And then he comes back to you and he says, "Felix, can you give me some advice? Now I'm a professional. What are all the pitfalls out there that I need to watch out for when I go into the real world of professional boxing? All the distractions, all the things that you hear about that aren't good. You know, if you spent 30 seconds with the kid, what are you going to tell him?"
Give him somebody you can trust and that you know is going to do good by you. There's a lot of people out there just want you for your money, just trying to go for your name and just build themselves off your name. Go with your heart, and if there's somebody out there that you know you can trust, go with him. Because like now, for instance, Mike Tyson, he don't got nobody behind him that he can trust, so he's in trouble. So you do got to follow your heart and depend on who you've been around with.
Now, so you get a guy like Buddy McGirt who's in your corner, okay, and somebody like Arturo Gatti can trust him,
right?
And he's pointing him in the right direction, and he's doing good by him. When you see Gatti fight, do you see any of McGirt in Gotti?
I see a lot of McGirt in Gotti because he just got a lot of heart. He just keep coming, you know, and that's what McGirt put into Gotti. Gotti already had the heart, and he always kept fighting, but McGirt turned around into another direction, which making him a winner now instead of just a taker. He used to get taken a lot of punches. Now he's more of a mover. McGirt showed him how to do that, and now he's a winner.
So basically, what the trainer's going to do is he's going to take a kid with some desire, with some stamina, with some talent, and he's going to mold him into a fighter who can, you know,
who can
win
do
when the chips are down.
Right, and okay. That's what Buddy McGirt does for his fighters.
How far away were you from getting the Olympics?
I was say maybe five fights in nationals, and then he still had the Olympic trial, so I still had a way to go. So it was still a way to go.
More than half the way there, though?
A little more than halfway.
Yeah.
So I got to the nationals, then next step is the Olympic trials. So yeah. It was pretty good step.
Good for you. If you had to go out and you guys would go around a horn here, if you went to a junior high school, which I'm sure you do, you know, when you had to speak in an auditorium full of students that are, you know, 11, 12, 13 years old, and, you know, they're interested in doing something constructive with their lives. You guys are obviously talking to them mm-hmm. in a boxing sense, but, you know, in terms of character and discipline, what are some of the things, Felix, if we could start with you, that you would say to the youngsters out there to maybe point them in the right direction?
Well, I went to one of my son's school and told them, look, the best thing you can do is stay in school, get your degree, and that will point you in the right direction. A lot of kids want to just get out of school, go to work. That's not the way to go. You know, if you can stay in sports, it'll put you in the right direction and do it that way. But definitely stay in school and go to college and get your degree.
John, what does sports teach you about your own internal character that help you down the road?
Well, sports is, there's winning, there's ups and downs, just like life. You're going to win, you're going to lose. But it builds your characters. If you can get back up off the ground and come back from a defeat and make it a victory for you in life.
So boxing parallels life?
In a sense, yeah. You find out some of the guys that don't make it to the top, but they end up being very good citizens.
Jody, you've certainly seen the good, the bad with fighting locally. You know, you've probably seen some kids that have given boxing a shot for a while and have quit on it and haven't really end up where they wanted to. And you've probably seen some other guys that have used boxing as a vehicle to, again, point them in the right direction or at least get them going to the point where they could function in everyday society. You know, you've seen all sides of it. You know, then taking those experiences and speaking to some youngsters, what are you going to tell them?
I just kind of like what these guys said, and the most important thing is you know, the school part, stay in school, and just talk from my own experiences, and you know, do your best there, and you know, respect and people on the outside. You know, I don't want to hear that the kids are out fighting in the streets and stuff, because they won't be welcome in the gym for a while. Sure. You know, it'd be like any other sport, and there's going to be consequences to pay. And I mean, one of the kids, Joey DeFosi, is coming on the show, the second half. He's an honor roll student, and you know. His name was in the paper for boxing one day, and was in for the honor roll, and I pinned it up on the door at the gym.
So it's important for your boxers to be good kids,
absolutely.
Good citizens,
and kids that are older. You know,
workers.
One of the guys that have Jesse Colon is coming on. He's 22. He's a kid that's working, and you know, he's a kid that you know, he'll talk on his own. That he's a crossroad, and this is doing it for him.
I want to take this opportunity to thank John. I want to take this opportunity to thank Felix. John,
thank
pleasure
you.
Having you on again. Felix, pleasure to meet you.
Thank
I'm excited
you.
That you got to spend some time here on Sports Fans. We're going to throw some footage up there of some of the guys working in Jody's gym, and we'll be right back in a few minutes with some of the youngsters that will be fighting in December at the Silver Gloves Tournament at Teachers Memorial. So stay tuned, Sports Fans.